Hello children, hope you all are well and safe at home. Today I am here with a new chapter, Direct and Inverse Proportion. So without wasting time, let's begin the chapter.
Direct and indirect proportion are related to our daily life problems and very often we deal with such a situation. So have a look at these. If two balls cost rupees 68, then five balls will cost rupees 170. More balls will cost more. If three boys can do a piece of work in 8 days, then one boy will complete the work in 24 days. So less men at work, more will be the time taken to complete the work. And vice versa. If more men will be there at the work, then less will be the time taken to complete the work. The more the area of the parking lot, the more will be the number of cars parked. More the money deposited in a bank, more is the interest earned. More the number of workers, less will be the time taken to complete the work. Faster the speed of a car, the lesser is the time taken to cover a given distance. More the number of boys in hostel, more the consumption of food. So you have seen that these here the quantities are related with each other. So what is now variation? If the value of two quantities depend on each other in such a way that a change in one results in a corresponding change in the other, then the two quantities are said to be in variation. For example, more the distance covered by a car, more the petrol consumed by it. The types of variation. So there are two types of variation. One is direct proportion and another one is indirect proportion or inverse proportion. Now what is direct proportion? Two quantities X and Y are said to be in direct proportion if the increase or decrease in the value of X is accompanied by the corresponding increase or decrease in Y. So if X and Y are in direct proportion, then X upon Y, that is equals to k. That means the ratio of x and y will be a constant, or you can say x is equals to ky. Now let's understand it in a better way. So if the cost of one toy is rupees 10, two toys cost will be rupees 20, three toys rupees 30. So what you have noticed, when the number of toys are increased, the price is also increasing. Or if you decrease it, if three toys cost rupees 30, then two toys will cost rupees 20, one toy will cost rupees 10. So what you have noticed, that when the one quantity is increasing, another one is also increasing. Or when the another one quantity is decreasing, the other one is also decreasing. So this type of variation is called what? Direct variation. Now inverse proportion. What is inverse proportion or indirect proportion? So when two quantities are related with such that the product of both the quantities is a constant, then we say that X and Y are in inverse proportion or vary inversely. Example by example you can understand. If a car is moving at a speed of 10 km per hour, then it will cover the distance in 2 hours. Suppose a particular distance it has to cover, it will cover in 2 hours. If the speed of the car is increased by 20 km per hour, then the time taken by the car will be how much? More will be the speed of the car, less it will take time. So it will become 1 hour. Similarly, if the car is speed is increased by 30 km per hour, then what you will notice, that it will take nearly 40 minutes. So the time will be decreased, it will become less. As the increases the speed of the car, the time of the duration taken by the car to complete the journey is decreasing. So what you have noticed that when you increase one quantity you are increasing, the speed you are increasing, the time is decreasing here. So when one quantity is increasing, the time is decreasing here. That means there is an indirect variation or indirect proportion. So when one quantity increases and another one decreases, or one quantity decreases and the next one is increasing, that means they are related with each other through inverse proportion. Now how to represent it? So here x is inversely proportional to y. This you can show by x is inverse. This is the sign of proportionality. So x is inversely proportional to this 1 upon y, or inversely proportional to y. So when you will remove this proportionality sign, this will be equals to k. Here k is the constant of proportionality. So that means that both the quantity product is always a constant. Through graphs, if you want to understand, see here, when direct proportion is there, you can see the curve is a straight line, which shows when the small quantity is there, when there is one quantity is less, another one will be also less. When one quantity increase, other one is also increasing. So that's why we are getting a straight line. But in inverse proportion, when one quantity is increasing, another quantity is decreasing. So this is inverse proportion. So direct proportion is what? More articles purchased, the cost, total cost increases. More petrol, more the distance traveled. So quantity x increases, so the quantity y is also increasing. When the quantity x is decreasing, so quantity y is also decreasing. That means x is directly proportional to this y. Means if x will increase, y will also increase, and if x is decreasing, then y is also decreasing. So when you will remove the sign of proportionality, this will be equals to this proportionality. When you will remove, it will be equals to x is equals to ky, where k is the sign of, this is the proportionality constant, or the ratio of x by y will be k. That means that there x and y, both the quantities will have a fixed ratio. Or in other word, you can say here that x1 upon y1 will be equals to x2 upon y2 is equals to x3 upon y3. Means if you find the ratio of the both the quantities, it will be always fixed. It will be a constant. So this is the direct proportion. Now inverse proportion or indirect variation. Here y varies inversely as x. So y is inversely proportional to x. When y is increasing, x is decreasing. Or when y is decreasing, then x will increase. And I have explained you already that this x is inversely proportional to this. Here y is there, so y is inversely proportional to this x. And when you remove the sign of proportionality, it will be replaced by k upon x, where k is the sign of a constant, proportionality constant, or yx is equals to k. That means the product of both the quantity will always be a constant. So x1 y1 will be equals to x2 y2 will be equals to x3 y3, and all will be constant. So the product of both the quantity will be equals to a constant if both the quantities are in inverse proportion. Now let's solve few question on this. If a table is given to you and it is asking find whether x and y are in direct proportion or not. So you have to check whether x and y are in direct proportion or not. So you can see here x1 is what here? 3 and y1 is 9. x2 is 5 and y2 is 15. x3 is 8 and y3 is 24. So you have to check that whether it is in direct proportion or not. So what we will do, we will find out the ratio of these quantities and then we will check whether they are equals to a constant or not. So let's do it. So 3 upon 9, bring it to the lowest term. So this will be equals to 1 ratio 3. Now next one is 5 upon 15. Bring it into lowest term. This will be 1 by 3. 1 ratio 3. Last one, 8 upon 24. Bring it into lowest term. This will also be equals to 1 is to 3. So you have noticed that all the 3 x1, y1, x2, y2 and x3, y3 all are in a fixed ratio. So that means the given x and y is in direct proportion. Now in the next question it is given that x and y are directly proportional. Find the value of x1, x2 and y1 in the table given below. So it is given here x and y and they are related with each other in direct proportion. It is already given to you. And few values are unknown, we have to calculate. So as you know that in direct proportion x1 upon y1 is equals to x2 upon y2 is equals to x3 upon y3, means they are in a fixed proportion. The quantities are related with each other in a fixed proportion. And as you know, you cannot calculate two unknown quantities. So what we will do, we will find out with the help of this one. First of all, we will put 3 upon 72 is equals to x1 upon 120 and then we will calculate the value of x1 here. Once the value of x1 is calculated, now with using any of these two, you can solve it. But you cannot calculate two unknown quantities, that you have to take care. So let's do it now. So x is given to you 3 and y is given to you 72. This will be equals to x1 upon 120. Do the cross multiplication and find out the value of this x1. When you will solve, you will get the value of x1 equals to 5. Now similarly, you can use these two to find out 3 upon 72 is equals to x2 upon 192. Do the cross multiplication and solve it, and this way you will get the value of x2. So this way you will find out the value of x1, x2 and y1. So it's explained here 3 upon 72 will be equals to x2 upon 192. So when you will solve, you will get the value of x2 equals to 8. Similarly, you will use the relationship 3 upon 72 is equals to x 10 upon y1. Solve it, you will get the value of y1 equals to 240. So this way you will calculate this question. Now the next question is, a taxi charges a fare of rupees 2550 for a journey of 150 km. So how much would it charge for a journey of 124 km? So as you know, if more distance is traveled, that means there will be more price. But in this case it is given that less distance is traveled, that means less price will be there, less will be the fare, which means this is a clear case of direct proportion. So let's solve it. So it is a case of direct proportion. As you know,
That means the ratio of x1, y1 will be equals to the ratio of x2, y2. And we have to calculate how much will be the fare. Let the fare will be equals to x. That then do the cross multiplication. When you will solve, you will get here 2108 rupees. So when the distance traveled by the taxi is 124 kilometer, it will have a fare of 2108. The next question is, a loaded truck travels 16 km in 25 minutes at the same speed, how much it can travel in 5 hours? So it is given here that in 25 minutes the loaded truck is covering 16 km. So at the same speed, if the speed remains constant, how far will it travel in 5 hours? So 5 hours it is given. First this hour you need to convert into, because you know you have studied in proportion and ratio that the quantity should have the same unit. So here it is given the time in 25 minutes and here the time is given in hours. So what you will do, this 5 hours you will convert into minutes. So 1 hour 60 minutes, so 5 hour will be equals to 300 minutes. Now the units are same and you all are knowing that if in 25 minutes the truck is traveling 16 km, so obviously in 5 hours it will cover more distance. So this is a clear case of direct proportion. So you can solve it. As you know, the ratio of both the quantities will always be same. That means x1 y1 will be equals to x2 y2. Put the values here, whatever you are knowing here in the question, what is given, and then solve and you will get the answer. The next question is, if 9 kg of sugar costs rupees 238 rupee and 50 paisa, how much sugar can be bought for rupees 371? So if 9 kg of sugar cost is rupees 238 and 50 paisa, and so if you are having 371 rupee, so obviously if more money is there, so more sugar will be purchased. That means when the quantity is increasing, the price is increasing, the quantity will also be increased. That means it is also a clear case of direct proportion. So let us consider that the quantity of sugar bought for rupees 371 will be x kg. So now we will use the formula, x1 upon y1 is equals to x2 upon y2. The value of x is 9, x1 is y 9, and the value of y1 is 238.50, and x2 value is given here, x we have to find out, and y2 is given to you 371. Now do the cross multiplication and solve it. You will get the value, the quantity of sugar bought for rupees 371 is 14 kg. Now the next question is, in 8 days the earth pick up 6.4 into 10 raised to the power 7 kg of dust from the atmosphere. How much dust will it pick up in 15 days? So 8 days, 6.4 into 10 raised, raised to the power 7 kg of dust. So if 15 days will be there, more amount of dust will be picked up by the earth. So that means this is also a clear case of direct proportion. So you know the relationship, the formula, x1 upon y1 will be x equals to x2 upon y2. Now put, you have to put the values of x1, y1 and then x2, y2, then do the cross multiplication, and once it will be solved, then write it into the standard form and you can convert into kg also. So this way you will calculate. The question is, 11 men can dig 6 holes 3 by 4 meter long trench in one day. How many men should be employed for digging 27 meter long trench of the same type in one day? So as you know, there is a relationship here between men and work. Less men will be there, less work will be there. More men will be there, more work will be there. So that means this is in direct proportion. So it is given here, the relationship is between men and
work, that is the length of the trench. So when 11 men are there, 6 holes 3 by 4 meter of the trench has been dug in one day. So if 27 meter trench has to be dig, then how many men will be required, that is asked. So this is indirect proportion, and as you know, indirect proportion x1 upon y1 is always equals to x2 upon y2. Now as you know, here x1 is 11, y1 is 6 holes 3 by 4, x2 is, you have to calculate, and y2 is 27 here.
So as we can see here, the number of men is 11, then the length of the trench is 27 upon 4, and when the number of men we are not knowing, but the length of the trench is given to you 27. So clearly, the longer the trench, the greater will be the number of men required. So using the formula x1 upon y1 is equals to x2 upon y2, we'll put the values of x1 y1 and x2 y2 here, and then we'll solve it, and when you will solve, you will get the value of x equals to 44. That means 44 men are required to dig a trench of 27 meter in one day. Now let's do the next question. Observe the table given below and each case find whether x and y are in inversely proportional or not. So for checking that whether they are in inverse proportion or not, what we have to do here? We have to see that whether this x, the product of x and y in each case, is it equal or not. So that means we have to check whether x1 y1 is equals to x2 y2 is equals to x3 y3 or not here. So x1 y1 is equals to x2 y2 is equals to x3 y3. We have to check here. X1 is 6 here and y1 is 9 here. X2 is 10 here and y2 is 15. And x3 is 14 and y3 is 21. So product of 6 and 9 is equals to 54. And the product of 10 and 15 is equals to 150. And clearly you can see they are not equal. And this will also be not equal. So that means we have verified here that x1, y1 is not equals to x2, y2 is not equals to x3, y3. That means it is not inversely proportional. Now let's check the second case. So here x1, y1, the product of x1, y1, if you see 18 5s are 90. The product of 9 and 10, this will be 90. And the product of 15 and 6, this is also 90. That means the product of x1, y1 is equals to the product of x2, y2 is equals to the product of x3, y3. So in this case, you have noticed that the product is constant in each case, which means that it is inversely proportional. So this way you can check whether the terms x and y are inversely proportional to each other or not. Now the next question is, if x and y are inversely proportional, then find the value of x1, y, x2, y1 and y2 in the table given below. So here if you see here, what is given here, x1 is missing here. And in this one, y2 is missing here. And the value of x and y is given here. So, what we will do? We will take these two, because two unknown quantities we cannot find out with one equation. So, we will take this value of x and y and we will check with this. We will put these two equal. So, xy will be equals to this x1 into 4. Now xy is what here? 16 into 5, and this is equals to x1 into 4. Now we can solve this. So 4 will cancel this 16 4 times, and 5 fours are 20. That means the value of this x1 will be equals to 20. Similarly, in the next case, what we will do? This xy will be equals to this 8 into y1 here. The value of x is 16, the value of y is 5. This is equals to 8 into y1. This you cancel. So y1 will be equals to 10. So this way, using the formula x1 y1 is equals to x2 y2, you can find out the value of the unknown quantities if they are inversely proportional. Now the next question is, a car takes 5 hours to reach a destination by traveling at a speed of 60 km per hour. How long will it take when the car travels at a speed of 75 km per hour? So what you have noticed here, when the car is traveling at a speed of 60 km per hour, it is taking 5 hours of time. If the speed is 75 km, so when the speed will be increased, the time taken by the car to reach the destination will be less. That means when the speed we have increased, the time is decreasing. So one quantity increase, another one is decreasing. That means it is in indirect variation. So let us consider that the time taken by the car in reaching the destination will be equals to x here. Now let's solve it. So clearly, you can see here, we will use the formula. Since it is in inverse proportion, so we'll use the formula x1 y1 is equals to x2 y2. And now x1 y1, you will put the value 60 into 5, and y1, x1 into y1. So that is 75 multiplied by x. Now solve this and you will get the value. The car will reach its destination in 4 hours if it travel at a speed of 75 km per hour. Now question number 9 is, 8 taps of the same size fill a tank in 27 minutes. If 2 taps go out of order, how long would the remaining taps take to fill the tank? So in the question, what is given? That 8 taps are there and they are taking 27 minutes. Now suppose if 2 taps become out of order, means out of 8 taps only 6 are working now, 2 are not working. So when 6 taps will be there, obviously they will take more time in filling the tank. So that means let the time taken by the 6 taps in filling the tank will be equals to x. Then since you can see here, when the quantity here, one of the quantity is decreasing, the other quantity is increasing. When the number of taps are less, so they will take more time to fill the tank. So one quantity decreased, another quantity increased. So that means this is a clear case of indirect variation. So we'll use the formula x1 y1 is equals to x2 y2. Now put the quantities x1 8 into this y1 will be 27, and here x2 is 6 and y2 we have considered as x. So x will be equals to 8 into 27 upon 6. Solve it. So by 3 you can do here. So that means it will take 9 into 4, which is equals to 36 minutes. That means 6 taps will take 36 minutes of time in filling the tap. Now the next question is, a garrison of 900 men had provisions for 42 days. However, a reinforcement of 500 men arrived. So for how many days will the food last now? So according to the question, what is given here? So what is given here that if 900 men are there, they have food for 42 days. And an enforcement of 500 men means 900 people are already there and 500 more people joined them. So now the number of people is increased. Now it become 1400. So if 1400 men will be there, obviously the food which was lasting for 42 days, now it will not last for 42 days. It will be consumed within few days only. So that means when one of the quantity increase, another quantity is decreasing. So let the number of days the food last will be equals to x. Now as you know the formula x1 y1 is equals to x2 y2. So we will use the formula here and we'll find out that in how many days the food will last. So let's do it. So when 900 men x1 y1, so 900 multiplied by 42, this will be equals to 1400 when the number of 500 people more joined. So 1400 multiplied by x, when you will solve the value of x here, you will get 27. That means the food will last in 27 days when a reinforcement of 500 people arrived in that.
And the last question we are going to discuss today, that is, a school has 9 periods a day, each of 40 minute duration. How long would each period be if the school has 8 periods a day, assuming that the number of school hours to be the same?
Means the length of that or the time duration of the school is same only. So now it is asked, instead of 9 periods, if there will be 8 periods only, so what will be the duration of each period? So when 9 periods are there, the duration of each was 40 minutes. So when 8 period will be there, then the duration of each period will be how much? It will be obviously more. The time period will be more because the total time is divided in 8 part only. So that means each period will be of more length. The duration of each period will be more. So what you have noticed here, that when the duration, when the time period, when the number of periods is decreased, the duration of each period is increased. That means it is a clear case of inverse proportion. So how we will solve? You all know that in inverse proportion we use the formula x1 y1 is equals to x2 y2. Here x1 is 9 and y1 is 40, x2 is 8 and y2 we have to calculate, that we have considered as x here. So now solve it. 8 5s are 40. So x will be equals to 9 5s are 45. That means the duration of each period will be equals to 45 minutes. So this way what you have find out, that the duration of each period will be of 45 minutes. So this way we have completed the chapter now. I hope you have understood it. Now your homework is to complete both the exercises, exercise 12A and 12B in your copy.